Lord, open our eyes to see and our ears to hear, our souls to comprehend and our bodies to work out the word that you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Fraternal twins at work. How many of you are a twin? Anybody here a twin? None? We don't have any here. Any in your family? Anybody got siblings or kids? Okay, that you have some twins in your family. So there's identical twins that do look, you know, identical virtually, unless you know them really well. I had a couple girls in high school that I never did, even after 4 years, couldn't tell the two of them apart. But then there's fraternal twins that look similar but not identical. And so today we're talking about fraternal twins, a couple of twins at work. It's Labor Day weekend, so we ought to talk about work. And I'm guessing that at some point for each of you, when you start thinking about work, that, you know, Labor Day is that sort of that gift, that extra day off that we get for all the labor we do for the rest of the year. But today I want to talk about our time at work. And I'm guessing that most of you who have been in the workforce for any length of time have probably had a boss who wasn't the best. Anybody ever have that? I had that. I was a waiter at a hotel restaurant, and one of the agreements we had is that I would never work Sunday mornings, and she one time put me on the schedule for Sunday morning. Only once did I do it. Next time she did it, I said, no, we had an agreement, and I wouldn't do it, which meant I had to work every Saturday, because that was only fair to the other employees, that if I wouldn't work Sunday, then somebody else didn't have to work Saturday, and I agreed to that. And this particular boss did a lot of things just to make life miserable for most of us, except for her favorites. And so many of us have had those kind of experiences, I think, where, gosh, we just can't wait to get done with that job and get on to something else or get through the day. Well, if that's ever been your experience or currently is, this story's for you. There was a man in a hot air balloon who realized he was lost. He reduced his altitude and spotted a woman below. He descended a bit more and he shouted to her,
"Excuse me, can you help me? I promised a friend I would meet him an hour ago, but I don't know where I am."
The woman below replied, "You're in a hot air balloon, hovering approximately 30 feet above the ground. You're between 40 and 41 degrees north latitude and 59 and 60 degrees west longitude." "Well, you must be an engineer," said the balloonist. "I am," replied the woman. "How did you know?"
"Well, everything you told me technically is correct, but I've no idea what to make of your information. And the fact is, I'm still lost. Frankly, you've not been much help at all. If anything, you've delayed my trip."
The woman below responded, "You must be in management." "I am. How did you know?" "Well," said the woman, "you don't know where you're going. You've risen to where you are by using a large quantity of hot air. You made a promise which you don't seem to be able to keep, and you expect people beneath you to solve your problems. The fact is, you are in exactly the same position you were before we met, but somehow now it's my fault." Let's look at our scripture text for today. One of the two, and these are our fraternal twins. The fraternal twins at work I'm talking about is a passage from Ephesians and a passage from Colossians. And they are not identical, but they are what I would call fraternal twins. You see, for those of you who have studied the scripture at all, you're familiar that Matthew, Mark, and Luke, three of the four gospels, are called the synoptic gospels because they are so similar. They have some verses in them that are identical to one another, and others that are more like fraternal twins or even triplets in that case, that they're very similar, but each one gives a little bit different shade of the story. Well, we don't see that as much in the letters of Paul until we get to this place. And actually, Ephesians chapter 6 and Colossians chapter 3, the whole chapters are very similar, but we're looking at just a part of it for today. So Ephesians first, chapter 6, verses 5 through 8. Is that? Go ahead and give a click. There we go. There it is. So you can see it. It says, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether slave or free." Okay, now let's look at the fraternal twin. Not exactly the same thing, but very similar. Colossians chapter 3, verses 22 through 25. Says, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything. And do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward, it is the Lord Christ you are serving." Very similar, are they not? They are. So I thought they have slight differences, though. And what would it be if we mashed them together, if we put them together so we get the fuller picture of what the Apostle Paul was trying to say? Because my guess is, very good guess, I believe, is that this was a part of Paul's sermons. You see, Paul would preach the same sermons over and over because he traveled. That's one of the blessings about being in management in Christian ministry, that you go different places to preach and you only need about three sermons, and you make them really good. So Paul, very likely, this was part of his sermons. He maybe didn't have it written down exactly, but he kind of said the same thing. So if we mash them together, then we come up with, if it's Ephesians and Colossians, with the word Ephesus, right? Or Ephesians. Ephesians, go ahead and click there. There's the text. Go ahead and click another one. Ephesians, or what I like better is Colossians, is what we could call this. And if you put all the verses together the way I have, you'd come up with, go ahead and click, chapter 63 of Ephesians, verses 225 through 258. If you look at it closely, you can see how I came up with those numbers and verses. Are we rewriting scripture? No. We're simply looking at the full picture of what the Apostle Paul said about these two things. So here's how I mashed them together. It would say, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything with respect and fear. Do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey and give reverence to Christ. Whatever you do, work at it wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not men, since you know that everyone will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. It is the Lord Christ you are serving." Now, before applying any of this text or this mashed up text to our work environment, we need to understand the context of why Paul wrote this two different times. Ephesians 6 and Colossians 3 are both about a Christian household. They're not about the workplace. In fact, they first both talk about the relationship between a husband and a wife and how a Christian husband and wife ought to view one another and how they ought to live with one another and the character and the qualities they should have with one another. Then it talks about parents and children and both, the way each should respond in the Christian household. And then continuing that, again, it's still not about work. He then goes on to talk about slaves and masters because that was a part of households. Now, note that nowhere does Paul condone slavery. However, he does accept it as the societal norm of the day, something that he can't change, but he can exhort the Christian slave and the Christian slave owner, as he did with Philemon in regards to his slave Onesimus, to bring him back home as a brother in Christ, not simply as a slave. But Paul knew that this was the society in which they lived as well, and so he addressed the slave and the slave owner to live a life worthy of Christ, whether you are slave or free. Now, since we can't make a direct connection, let's look at the principles of Scripture, right? Because we all know that slavery is in any form wrong, and so nobody should be a slave owner. But there are principles about work from this, I believe, that we can take. All right, so we know the context. We know it was about the Christian household of that day. But for us, for it to have meaning, I think it easily applies to our work context. So let's kind of, now that I put it together, those two fraternal twins, let's just sort of start breaking it apart piece by piece. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything. If this is about a student or an employee, it simply means do what you're supposed to do, right? Without arguing, whining, complaining, just do it. Unless you're called to cross a moral or spiritual line that you shouldn't cross, do the work that you are supposed to do. Well, and how are you supposed to do that? It says with respect and fear. In other words, honor those who have somehow attained the position that they are in, which is a position of authority over you, whether it's your teacher or the principal at your school or your boss or your supervisor or somebody in one of those positions. It goes on, and do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ and give reverence to him. Don't just work well when your boss or your teacher is watching you to try to get a raise or to look good in their eyes, right? Do good when no one's watching. That provides for us, I think, a great Christian ethic, a great way to live, which, besides, God does see everything that you're doing all the time. So even if you are sloughing off, student or employee, God still sees it, even though your boss or teacher may not. It says do it wholeheartedly. You do it with the right heart, not just the right mind. You work well at your job because it honors Christ. You honor Christ in doing a good work, a good job, when you use your mind and your body to the very best of your ability to do whatever you're called upon to do, where you spend the majority of your time. Think about that. Where is most of your time, outside of sleeping, where is most of your time spent? It's spent either at school or at your workplace. You can't call stuff you do at church sacred and stuff you do at work secular. Neither one is either. In fact, church can be very secular. But it's Christ in you that makes church and or work sacred. Both are sacred because it is Christ living in us. Being a Christian who works well in your employment is a high calling. Pastor is no higher calling than truck driver or secretary. It's Christ in us that gives us all a high calling to do our very best. Or if you're a student, you honor Christ when you are the best student that you can be. I messed this one up. I wasn't a Christian when I was going through school, so I have an excuse, right? What's your excuse? If you are in the eighth grade and you know Jesus, what's your excuse for not doing well? Because when you do well, you honor Christ. It isn't about just getting good grades. Follow Jesus into every classroom and do your best for him. Follow Jesus into the break room at work, into every place that you go to when you're at work. It says, whatever you do, work at it wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men. Grow in your skill set. Work hard. Strive for excellence. In fact, Proverbs 22:29 says, do you see a man skillful in his work? He will stand before kings. He will not stand before obscure men. Proverbs 14:23, in all toil there is profit, but mere talk tends only toward poverty. Matthew 5:16, in the same way let your light so shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. I bet any time you've ever read that, you thought, oh, my good works are the things that I do in and through the church, right? Well, what about just the good works that you do in your daily life? By the way, all of this applies to retired people, too, in your retirement. But when you're at work, your good works, just doing them well, glorifies the Christ you are serving. Now, truthfully, your reward at school for doing well is what? Good grades. Your reward at church for doing your job is what? Your paycheck every week or two or however often you get paid. But your real reward has two aspects that go beyond the paycheck or the grades. Because one day you will hope to hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Again, does that just mean the things you did at and through church? Or does that mean how you lived your life, again, where you spend most of your time? At your job. At your job. That Jesus can say, "Well done, you lived your life for me in every part of your life, my good and faithful servant." And your reward now is knowing that you're doing your best for Christ every day of your life, at work or at play, that he takes delight in the job that you do, and you do it well. In fact, here's how you honor Christ. When you recognize that you are a better student or a better employee or employer because you follow Jesus than you would be if you were not a follower of Jesus. Did you get that? You're a better employee or employer or student because you follow Jesus than you would be if you weren't a follower of Jesus. See how easy that is to understand how we honor Christ in that? That Jesus can look at us and go, look, they're not doing a perfect job. They're not always the best. Yep, occasionally they slough off. Occasionally they maybe do a bad job. But they're striving. They're thriving, as the song says. They're doing their best, and they honor me in that. And I know that when they weren't following me, they weren't trying their best. They were working just for the paycheck or the good grade. In fact, the scripture says when we do it that way, we give glory to our Father who is in heaven. Now, what if you have a horrible or frustrating boss or work situation? Well, if it's something that can't be changed and there's no moral issues involved, you still do your best. You don't do a lesser job. You don't try to retaliate against that person if you are a follower of Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18 says, "Slaves," staying with that same metaphor, "submit to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps." If you have a boss who lords their position over you and it can't be changed, you can't quit that job, you can't go do something else, work as though you're working for Jesus, not for that person. And let the quality of your work show who you are really working for, regardless of what anyone else does or says. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 21 says, "If your enemy is hungry, give him something to eat. If your enemy is thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head, and the Lord will reward you." I know what you're thinking. Those of you who have a really stinker of a boss are thinking, "Oh, good. The Bible just told me I can heap burning coals upon the head of my boss. All I have to do is be nice to him. All I have to do is do a good job." I think you missed the point of this text. The point of this text is you do it to honor Christ, and Christ will reward you. And because of that, because that person won't be able to stand it. When all of a sudden, if you go in Tuesday morning, and I say Tuesday because you're probably off tomorrow, if you go in Tuesday with a new attitude, with desiring to serve Jesus and to do your very best, your boss is going to go, "What? Who are you and what happened to you? Wait a minute, all of a sudden you're giving glory to Christ because you're approaching your job or your schoolwork in a new way. I know if I had heard this and I applied it when I was in school, my teachers would have probably fallen out of their chairs, meaning they would have had burning coals on their head. All right, check out this picture. On the cover of the New York Herald Tribune Sunday magazine a couple years ago, there's a picture of the Statue of Liberty taken from a helicopter. Now, this obviously is before that. This is when it's being made, of course. But a few years ago, when these pictures were taken, it showed the top of the statue's head, which you are seeing here. And it's amazing, kind of, isn't it, to see the detail of that. Can you see that? Can you see the hair on top of the head and all that? Well, the sculptor had done a painstaking job with the lady's hair. Yet he must have been pretty certain that the only eyes that would ever see the details of that hair on top of it were some old seagull flying over top, because the Statue of Liberty was dedicated in 1886. The Wright brothers didn't fly their first plane until 1903. And so the sculptor would have never dreamt that anybody would have ever seen the top of Lady Liberty, other than maybe somebody who had to go do some work on it. So why not just use what it was made out of and just make it bald? I mean, why take all of that time and do all of that work? Nobody's ever going to see it. But he was an artist, and he wanted to finish off this part of the statue with as much care as he had devoted to her face, her arms, her torch, and everything that people would see when they come up sailing toward the Statue of Liberty. You know, we never know what new technologies may come that will catch you working at your job or doing your work at school. But regardless of technologies that will see you, and they do, in fact, I didn't have my own coffee made at home today, so I stopped at Starbucks and Kroger, and when you're walking out of the door that's by that part of Kroger, there's a monitor, and it's showing what the camera is showing, and you know, it looks like one of those police things. It's not a perfectly clear picture even today with today's technology. It's slightly jerky or whatever, but I just noticed. I looked up and saw myself walking out and thought about how many places are we that we're seen by Big Brother, right? By somebody, or potentially are, because there's cameras everywhere. But God sees us always, and he desires us to do our very best for him every moment of our lives, and most particularly in this case, at our school and in our workplace. Let us do our very best for him. In fact, there was a boy who went to a farmer, and he asked to get a job, to be hired on. The farmer asked, "Are you willing to work hard?" "Oh, please, sir, I can sleep well on a windy night. Can you look after my things?" "Oh, please, sir, I can sleep well on a windy night." The farmer asked several more questions to determine if the boy was trustworthy, if he'd do a good job. And every question he asked, the boy just said, "I can sleep well on a windy night." Deciding that the boy might have a little bit of a mental challenge, the farmer hired him anyway because there was something about the boy that he liked. And the boy proved to be a willing worker, and everything went well until one night a big storm came up. The farmer heard the howling wind, and he rushed into the boy's room and said, "Get up! Let's go tie down the stacks of hay. Let's put the tools up, and let's secure the barn doors." But the boy was so sound asleep that the farmer couldn't wake him up. And instead of wasting more time, the farmer decided to go take care of all this himself. So he rushed out to see everything. And when he came to the haystacks, he found that they were already firmly tied. He found tools in their proper places, and he found the barn doors securely closed. And as he went back into his house, he realized what the boy meant about sleeping well on a windy night. He meant that each and every day he did his work well, and then when even the biggest storm came, he could sleep well on a windy night. Do your work well. Some sermons are descriptive. They describe God's work. And this describes a little bit of Jesus' work, right? His suffering on the cross for us. But it's more prescriptive. I'm prescribing to you out of the scripture, out of these fraternal twins that we've put together. And if Paul says it more than once, it's probably really important for us to pay attention to, that we ought to work as though we're working for the Lord and not for men. And if anybody is a follower of Jesus and a part of Ashland Church, I would hope that you are the best workers that any employers have, or you are the best employers that any employee has, or you are the best students or teachers or principals that anybody could have in the school system, or whatever your daily work is, that you are the best that you can be because you are a follower of Jesus and you believe in him.
Thank you.
Now glory be to God, who by his mighty power at work within us is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or even dream of, infinitely beyond our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, or hopes. Now glory be to God through the church and through Jesus Christ throughout all generations, both now and forever. And all those living their life for Jesus say, Amen.